The minivan was designed with families in mind, but it also revolutionized travel for people in wheelchairs. Retrofitted for wheelchair accessibility, the minivan offers unprecedented mobility. No need to wait for special wheelchair transportation when there's a minivan in the driveway. Convert a minivan and change a life. A wheelchair accessibility conversion offers the convenience of a ride anytime. From the outside, the van will look no different, but inside, the modifications will be major. The total revamp starts with the removal of the van's middle and third row seats. They pull out the carpet and completely strip the vehicle from the front seats to the back. Underneath, a technician saws off the exhaust system and disassembles the rear suspension. The entire undercarriage behind the engine is about to be reconfigured to make way for a new lowered floor. The team also removes the 76-liter fuel tank. They'll replace it with one of the same capacity to fit the new configuration. They cut out a large section of floor and relocate displaced wiring. They're now ready to roll the new floor framework into position below the vehicle. This steel structure replaces the original one and is strong enough to support the additional weight of a wheelchair. A motorized one can weigh as much as 4 adults. They slide the new steel floor into the vehicle and lower it into the framework. This new floor is significantly lower than the one the van came with, and it increases the wheelchair passenger's headroom by 30 to 40 centimeters. After installing the new fuel tank, suspension, and exhaust systems, they return to the interior. A technician fits and bonds carpet under padding to the van. He installs the carpet and clamps it while the adhesive cures. With the back of the van rebuilt and carpeted, they now ready the wheelchair ramp. A technician applies a gritty material with an adhesive backing. He simply presses it to the ramp and smooths out any air bubbles. This gritty material will provide a slip-resistant surface for the wheelchair to move across. He attaches a handle and installs two cable assemblies to connect the handle to the ramp latches. He attaches a return spring to the handle assembly. He turns the handle and tests the latches to confirm that the mechanisms function properly. The team then links the wheelchair ramp to the new floor with a long hinge. They install stainless steel trim over the hinge to protect it, and also connect the counterbalance cables to the ramp. Hidden springs at the end of the cables provide tension to significantly lighten the load for the operator. The ramp weighs 60 kilograms, but the operator ends up lifting just 7 kilograms of that due to the spring-loaded tension. They reinstall the interior plastic panels and repurpose the original second row seat belts. As they finish up inside, an employee puts the company name on the door of the vehicle. The wheelchair-converted van is now ready for a test drive. The operator unfolds the ramp. He folds away the new seats to make way for the wheelchair. He extends the tie-down belts and attaches them to the wheelchair. He wheels the passenger into the van, locks the wheelchair brakes, and ties the chair to the floor. There are standard seat belts to fasten, and then it's time to sit back and enjoy the ride. Ensconced in the converted minivan, the limited mobility individual can now experience the freedom of the road. Bowls have existed for thousands of years. Very early bowls, used to serve food or drink, have been found in China, ancient Greece, and in certain North American cultures. Modern bowls can be made from a variety of materials, such as ceramic, plastic, metal, and wood. Wood bowls come in many shapes and sizes. Many different kinds of wood are used to make bowls, such as rubber wood and teak. Acacia is also a type of wood used to make bowls. Workers cut flat planks of acacia using a large circular saw. The acacia was cut a few days ago in nearby plantations. Planks are cut to thicknesses required for bowl production and pre-dried on pallets, spaced apart for better air circulation. Using a table saw, a worker cuts the wood planks, now kiln-dried, into pieces long enough to make the bowl wall. Another worker uses a tilted table saw to cut the wood into shapes resembling a cone. Drying the wood eliminates water that might cause cracking later on. A worker trims the pieces, giving them the angle they need so the staves can be rounded later on. Another worker smooths the rough side of the staves with a spinning cutter. This also helps shape the wood pieces. Another employee lines up the staves on a table before applying glue. She spreads a wood bonding glue onto the sides of the staves. Once they're thoroughly covered with glue, she begins assembling the bowl by sticking the sides together. She assembles a few pieces at a time, handing them to another worker who arranges the bowl shape by leaning the staves against a centerpiece. They continue the process until all the staves are in place. Then they'll squeeze the staves tightly together. They stretch elastic bands around the outside of the eventual bowl. The elastics, held in place by a steel ring, squeeze the staves firmly against each other. With a hammer, she lightly taps the staves into place, making sure they are flush against each other. She turns the bowl over to make sure none of the staves around the top rim are sticking out too far. She then leaves the bowl to dry. About 5 hours later, they remove the elastics and, again, leave the bowl to harden for a full day. A template is attached to the eventual bowl in order to cut a circular opening for the bottom piece. The template serves as a guide during the cutting process. A worker moves the bowl around, allowing the cutter to create a perfectly sized hole for the bottom section of the bowl, which is made of the same kind of wood, in this case, acacia. A worker applies glue to the edges of the bottom hole and to the outer edge of the round piece that goes in the bottom of the bowl. He inserts the bottom plate and uses a hammer to force it firmly into place. After another day of hardening, a worker places the bowl in a lathe. With a variety of knives, he begins shaving off the wood. He starts on the inside wall of the bowl. Then he shaves the outside of the bowl, gradually giving it shape. He then uses sandpaper to smooth the surface of the bowl. Another worker then uses a lathe to sand the surface of the bowl. He makes the surface as fine as possible. He must have a keen eye for detail in order to make the bowl surface perfect. A worker sprays a foodstuff varnish onto the surface of the bowl. Several layers are applied, with drying and polishing after each one. If required, a stain is also applied. They place a sticker identifying the manufacturer on the bottom of the bowl. A worker then packages the wood bowl. With the bowl secure, the only thing tossed about will be the ingredients you put in it.